This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Thousands of Lebanese refugees who fled to Syria and the area of Midbiqa began to return to their homes and towns as soon as the declared time for cessation of military offensive operations in Lebanon went into effect. Hours before the ceasefire, Israeli warplanes intensified their airstrikes campaign, killing more than 15 civilians in various areas in Biqa.
The last Israeli warplane left Lebanon's airspace on Monday at 7:55 a.m. Life in Lebanon started to slowly but surely return to normal. Lebanese bustling streets, which were deserted for a long time, went back to normal as local residents reluctantly started to return to their homes and towns. During the past month, many Lebanese roadways witnessed hundreds of airstrikes that targeted civilian trucks and vehicles.
Thank God the situation went back to normal. We are now happy and relaxed.
I ask God to give the people peace. I wish the Lebanese people a good and stable life. I hope that no one, Lebanese and others, experience again this ordeal.
سيارات كثيرة عادت لتعبر شوارع البقاع حاملة.
Many displaced local residents reluctantly started to return from the Biqa Valley to their homes and villages. While some of the returnees went back to their places of work, others went back to check on their properties, and others went back to their homes which they had to leave more than one month ago.
ولكن ساعات الليل والفجر التي سبقت موعد وقف العمل.
As was expected by all Lebanese, the night and early morning hours that had preceded the assigned time for the cessation of military operations in Lebanon were described as intense and heavy. Israel launched four sorties of aerial raids shortly before midnight, targeting homes and commercial institutions in the town of Breital in northern Biqa. The massive destruction hampered rescue efforts that lasted throughout the night until early morning hours. Israeli airstrikes also targeted four civilian vehicles in the area of Taibi, north of Ba'labak, and a gas station on the outskirts of Ain al-Barudi, west of the city. Hours passed, and then more heavy bombardment took place. Israeli warplanes targeted a passenger vehicle, killing and injuring several Lebanese army and internal security personnel. Many of the victims were delayed in reaching hospitals due to the destruction of many roadways. This news came as Israeli surveillance and warplanes continued to hover the skies of Baqa. The Israeli air campaign lasted until the assigned time for the cessation of military operations went into effect. Bassam Al-Qadiri, Al Jazeera Television, Al Baqa.
وبسام القادري في إطار تجواله على مناطق البقاع الشمالي.
بسام القادري has been touring the northern, mid and southern regions of the Biqa. He's with us from the town of Mashghara in the southern Biqa. بسام, المشغرة has witnessed another horrific Israeli massacre, just like other areas in the Biqa. Can you describe the situation there for us? And did the displaced people actually start returning to the town?
إلى تلك البلدة.
نعم حسن، وصلنا قبل قليل إلى بلدة مشغرة في أقصى البقاع الغربي. هذه البلدة تفصل تقريبا ما بين.
Yes Hassan, we arrived a short while ago at the town of Mashghara in the far west of Al-Biqa. This town lies between the western Biqa and the southern areas. The city of Marj al-Ayun and other southern villages are behind these hills. Hassan, we decided to come to this town and this particular neighborhood for several reasons.
هنا في هذا المنزل العائد للسيد أحمد صادر.
First, because the massacre took place in this home, which belongs to Ahmed Sabir. He miraculously survived, but his family, including his sons, their wives, and their families, were killed in this massacre.
وعائلاتهم في هذه المجزرة سبعة شهداء كانوا تحت هذه الأنقاض، فيما نجا بأعجوبة الحاج أحمد صادر رب هذه الأسرة. السبب الآخر حسن الذي دعانا لننتقل إلى هذه المنطقة وهذا الحي بالتحديد هو أن البعض.
The bodies of seven martyrs were found underneath this rubble. Haj Ahmad Sabir, the head of the household, miraculously survived. He invited us to come to this neighborhood because some of its residents fled to other areas. He escaped the intensive shelling which lasted until the last hours of the war on Lebanon. This war stopped at 8 a.m. this morning, Beirut time. To learn more about what happened in this
ولا أكثر أولا على ما جرى في هذه المجزرة معنا السيدة تفضلي.
إذن we brought this lady. Peace be upon you. Can you introduce yourself?
Zina Abu Awala from Al Mashkara.
Can you tell us what happened in the massacre in this home?
أول شيء من نحكي للعالم العربي كله.
What can I say? First, I want to tell the whole Arab world and the Israelis in particular. Israel claims that they have been killing Hezbollah leaders. This is the home of Ahmad Sabir. He is a farmer. His son, Hassan, works for the power station. His wife is a school teacher. She teaches children about sacrifice and dignity. Israel is killing children so they do not grow up and defend their national honor. This is our guiding principle, and this is why we are steadfast. Second, Israel claims that it killed Mohammed Sabir. He was living in France and they can check his French passport. Israel can find out whether he was French or not. He was living and working abroad. He came recently to the town of Mashkara to help his family. He was the only source of income for his family.
إسرائيل وبتشوف إذا كان هو فرنسي أو لا. إنسان كان عم بيناضل وعم يشتغل برا وإجا جديد على بلدة مشغرة لحتى يعاين أهله يعيشهم لأنه أهله كل ما عيشتهم من وراء.
How many people were martyred in this massacre?
كلهم رجال كبير عمره 85 سنة ورجال وابنه حسان وزوجته وعلي ابنه.
Seven people. An 85-year-old man, his son Hassan and his wife. Ali, who was a carpenter, and his wife Nadia, another man called Muhammad. In total, seven people. We want to tell Israel that we are steadfast and we will not leave our country. We are behind Mr. Hassan Nasrallah. We will sacrifice our children, men, women, and blood for Mr. Hassan. We are willing to sacrifice our lives for the young resistance fighters.
شكرا حاج شكرا حسن. نعم. ايضا فيما خص عفوا اذا سمحتي فيما خص حاله النزوح.
Thank you. We also have this brother to tell us about the displacement of residents in this area.
اليوم معنا ايضا الاخ تفضل اذا سمحت.
Can you introduce yourself?
Ibrahim Hizzat Al-Amar.
Did you flee from this area and then come back?
I left along with Haj Ahmad Sabir. Haj Ahmad is now in Syria. He sent a letter and I would like to tell you what he said in it. Haj Ahmad is doing well. He is willing to sacrifice all his children for the homeland, the resistance, Mr. Hassan Nasrallah and Hezbollah.
When the war stopped this morning and you were away from this town, what was the first thing that you thought of?
The first thing I thought about is to come and see what happened in Mashghar. I wanted to see what happened to the young men who stayed in Mashghar. I want to see if they are okay. I wanted to see what happened in the massacre. The massacre happened in my grandfather's home. My grandfather's home is a four-story building. We stored food on the first floor. My uncles were living on the second and third floors, and my grandfather was living on the fourth floor. Only civilians were living on these four floors. One of my uncles has a French citizenship. Here it is.
So the people that were living here were civilians.
The wife of Haj Hassan Sadr taught children in the Najaf school.
So you came back to the village. Hassan, a lot of the displaced people have returned to their villages, towns and homes. Some are still waiting, perhaps because they want to make sure that the roads are safer. We will go to another location to bring you other images of Lebanon in the aftermath of the war.
سننتقل الى مكان اخر ومشاهد اخرى ما بعد الحرب على لبنان.
شكرا.
Thank you Bassam Al-Qadri from Mashghara town in the southern Biqa.
Thank you. A ceasefire in Lebanon went into effect at 8 o'clock this morning. It was broken twice today inside Lebanon. But for the most part, there has been an adherence to the ceasefire between Israeli troops and Hezbollah. Abiez Eli Walgelernter has that story.
The first ceasefire was broken mid-morning when an armed Hezbollah gunman in the western section of South Lebanon approached an IDF unit, quote, in a threatening way. Soldiers opened fire and shot the gunman. His condition is unknown. 3 hours later, a similar incident occurred in the eastern section, and IDF forces shot in self-defense and killed the gunman. Otherwise, all was quiet inside Lebanon today, and the first IDF troops began making their way back across the border by truck and on foot. Last night, Air Force, Navy, artillery, and other units received a clear order to completely honor the ceasefire and not create any incident which may heat up the region. A high-ranking officer said IDF troops would maintain their positions and would be ready to, quote, jump into any village or city, including Tyre, if necessary. The Army is recommending that once the ceasefire takes effect, Israel should begin withdrawing its forces from Lebanon relatively quickly. The intention is for the forces to move back to a line north of the border with Lebanon within about 10 days, or as soon as the Lebanese army is ready to begin entering South Lebanon. But can the ceasefire hold?
I will be happy if it's, this quiet will continue. But I'm not optimistic.
Quiet. You hear the cows, you hear the birds. This is a ceasefire. But we'll see what will happen now. Very optimistic, I want to be optimistic, but we have troops inside. They have their guns, out of sight. I don't know if it's safe like this.
Before the ceasefire, the IDF continued to launch offensive and defensive actions with artillery batteries firing shells nonstop at areas in southern Lebanon. The Air Force struck 178 terror targets, including 11 rocket launchers and 122 buildings, as well as headquarters, activist homes, tunnels, and petrol stations in its last sorties before the ceasefire went into effect. One fundamental issue which the IDF is facing is the 5 dead crew members of the Assur helicopter which crashed Saturday and who are still presumed missing. The Army is exerting efforts to locate their bodies before the forces have to leave Lebanon. Apart from that, more than 20 IDF vehicles, including tanks and armored vehicles which were hit during the fighting, were left on Lebanese territory. Several vehicles were rescued in the last few hours, but IDF officials admitted that time is running out, and they are now looking for solutions to get the other vehicles into Israeli territory. One solution being considered is to bomb the vehicles left behind to prevent Hezbollah from later standing on top of the tanks and waving their flag in victory. And Israel foiled a major attack hours before the ceasefire deadline when it shot down 2 unmanned drone planes loaded with explosives sent over Israel by Hezbollah last night. The explosives aboard were later detonated. Eli Wolgelanter, IBA News.
Just a short time ago, Prime Minister Ehud Olmert addressed the Knesset plenum, which convened in special session to debate the newly established ceasefire in Lebanon. Olmert opened his comments by offering condolences to the families of the fallen soldiers. He praised the bravery of the men and women of the IDF and took responsibility for the decision to go to war.
The responsibility for this operation lies with me as the Prime Minister. I have no intention, and I'm not asking, to share this responsibility with anyone whatsoever. This is the responsibility that results from the position of Prime Minister in Israel. This decision on the part of the Israeli government not to ignore what happened reverberated and will continue to reverberate for a long time in the capitals of the world, both those which are near and those which are far. And he made it very clear to every single person in the world that the state of Israel will no longer take on the chin without reacting any detraction from its sovereignty, that it would no longer turn its back on any harm inflicted on any of its citizens, and therefore it would react to any act of terrorism, whether from north or south, whether from east or from the sea, from anywhere, irrespective of where it comes from.
At the start of the session, Knesset Chairwoman Dalia Itzik called for the establishment of a national emergency government. In her comments, Itzik said that with the cessation of battles, Israel will have to learn lessons. We have the duty to learn lessons, said Itzik, not for yesterday, but for tomorrow.
Hezbollah Secretary General Hassan Nasrallah is praising the Lebanese people for unrivaled resistance they offered over 1 month, saying Lebanon is now facing a strategic and historical victory, which is a prestigious prize for their unflinching stiff resistance against the Zionist regime of Israel. In a televised address to the Lebanese nation, Nasrallah said hours ago, the Islamic resistance movement has pulled off success in an unequal war in which all Arab armies suffered humiliating defeats. Nasrallah, meanwhile, vowed to immediately begin paying money to families living in 15,000 homes completely destroyed in Israel's bombardment of Lebanon. Hezbollah boasted on Monday it had scored a divine victory in its resistance against Israel's aggression.
Hours after both sides ended hostilities in a UN-brokered ceasefire agreement that took effect 500 hours GMT, Hezbollah members handed out posters congratulating victory in the Islamic resistance group's fight against the Zionist regime. This came after tens of thousands of Lebanese headed back toward their homes in the south on Monday, as guns fell silent under the UN ceasefire agreement to end 5 weeks of conflict between Hezbollah and the Zionist regime of Israel. Hundreds made it to a string of villages south of the Litani River and east of the port city of Tyre, despite bombed-out roads and an Israeli ban on movements. Lebanese young and old cheered and talked of victory against Israel.
Following the great victory of Lebanese Hezbollah over the Zionist regime of Israel, people all across Iran took to the streets to celebrate the joyous triumph. Carrying yellow flags of Hezbollah, a cheerful mob joined music carnivals, distributing cookies and candies to passers-by. Hugs were also exchanged between the people on the momentous Hezbollah achievement.
Wael, what is the latest development in the Ayat al-Shab?
نعم منتهى طبعا نحن نحاول أن نبحث عن شهود عيان لما ليروا لنا ما حدث من أحداث مهمة هنا في هذه البلدة.
منتهى, we are trying to find some eyewitnesses to shed light on the most important events that took place in Ayat al-Shab, including news from the battlefield and the humanitarian situation there. As we all know, some of the most ferocious and intense battles have taken place in the town of Ayat al-Shab. The kidnapping of the two Israeli soldiers was also launched from this town. In an earlier interview, I talked to a 100-year-old man who refused to evacuate Ayat al-Shab, which had come under heavy Israeli bombardment. He told us that his house was shelled and that it collapsed on him. Today, we talked to his son. Brother, what is your name?
My name is Muhammad Abdul Karim Dakdou.
اخ سيد محمد الان انت شهدت تفاصيل مهمه وهي عمليه اختراق.
Muhammad, you witnessed an important event in the town of Ayat al-Shab. An Israeli incursion took place there. You said that you observed two Israeli tanks and one armored vehicle rolling into the town in order to recover the bodies of four dead Israeli soldiers. You said that the Israeli tanks and military vehicles passed near your house. We are now standing directly in front of your house, where the Israeli army tried to recover the bodies of four dead Israeli soldiers. Can you, Brother Abed al-Karim, tell us about this Israeli recovery operation?
طبعا تحدثنا أخ عبد الكريم عن هذه.
نعم. Yes. Of course. On July 22nd, four dead Israeli soldiers were left behind in the western part of Eit al-Shaab. An Israeli infantry force tried to recover the bodies of these dead soldiers. The Israelis usually come at night to recover the bodies of their dead soldiers. They carried out four unsuccessful operations to retrieve the bodies of four dead Israeli soldiers in the town of Eit al-Shaab. Several soldiers were killed in this recovery operation.
Can you tell us about this unsuccessful operation in which the Israeli tanks rolled in to the town of Eit al-Shaab?
دخلوا إلى البلدة من الناحية الشرقية وقتلهم في الناحية الغربية.
After the Israeli commandos failed to recover the bodies of their four dead soldiers, they used tanks and rolled into the east part of Eit al-Shaab. Then they proceeded to the west part of the town where the dead soldiers were left behind. The Israeli army used a bulldozer to clear the streets that were blocked by falling debris from damaged homes. Israeli tanks and a bulldozer rolled into the town and stopped at that intersection. You can see the destruction and the property damage left behind. The Israeli army used the bulldozer to knock down walls and houses so it could reach the location of the dead soldiers. The place is only 100 meters away from where we are now standing. The Israeli tanks damaged part of our house, almost killing us in the process. They missed our heads by only 2 meters.
مرت هذه الآليات وكانت لا تبعد جنازيرها عن رؤوسنا أكثر من مترين.
Were you in the house at that very moment?
Yes, we were at the house. The Israeli bulldozer knocked over one of the walls of our house. The wall collapsed inward, falling on top of us. The Israelis are cowards. They did not try to come out of their tanks. Then they left and came back moments later.
Were there any reports of clashes during this Israeli rescue mission?
Yes, as the Israelis were retrieving their dead soldiers, they came under fire. Armed men hit one Israeli tank that caught fire. Moments later, the Israelis fled the scene. However, we do not know whether or not they retrieved their dead soldiers. When they came back, they used the same route and passed again by our house.
هذا وانتقد منسق الأمم المتحدة لشؤون الإغاثة الإنسانية
United Nations Emergency Relief Coordinator Jan Egeland criticized Israel and Hezbollah for hindering humanitarian aid access to people affected by the ongoing conflict for the last 30 days. This comes as suffering intensified for tens of thousands of Lebanese who have been displaced from their villages in southern Lebanon due to Israeli bombardment. Many of them were forced to take refuge in areas unsuitable for human habitation. Hospitals are full of wounded civilians whose numbers exceed 3,500 and so cannot be accommodated.
30 يوما آلاف وآلاف الأطنان التي ألقتها الطائرات والمدافع وكانت كافية
30 days and thousands of tons of rockets fired by planes and tanks, enough to destroy a part of Beirut suburbs and a part of the Lebanese map. They were also enough to kill 1,000 civilians and injure 3,600 others, some of whom have lost their limbs and became permanently maimed. Dozens of others still lay under rubble in many besieged villages that rescue teams and ambulances cannot reach. One is unable to stop the Israeli death machine from committing more open massacres, which have become a daily occurrence in the lives of the Lebanese.
الجزيرة المفتوحة التي صارت خبزاً يومياً عند اللبنانيين.
This is the latest crime of our time. Civilians are being killed and their homes and property is destroyed. This is a crime. We are resisting the American-Israeli agendas. They are victimizing people for the sake of making their project work, and we know what their projects are about.
شهر كامل دفع بحوالي مليون إنسان لكي يمزحوا في أرجاء.
An entire month has displaced about 1 million people across the country. They live under harsh conditions in schools and government buildings and even in public parks and the industrial park. Roads have been cut off and hopes for a safe return have been shattered after Israeli planes destroyed what's below and above the ground.
إسرائيلية بتدمير ما هو تحت وفوق الأرض.
سوق تجاري.
This was a shopping center. There were no armaments. There were no Khyber 1 or Khyber 2 missiles. There were only clothing stores and residential homes. This is the whole story. Only God knows what they were targeting.
مستشفيات بيروت لا تزال.
The hospitals of Beirut are still trying to overcome the crisis, while the fuel crisis is threatening another disaster. A quarter of Lebanon's inhabitants have been displaced. Here, hundreds of families are living in the open field. An entire month has passed, and the question remains: will another month pass like this? For Almadar Program, Caroline Baini, Industrial Park, Abu Dhabi, Beirut.
The Iraqiya correspondent in Al Najaf, Al Ashraf province, said that 33 civilians were martyred and 100 others were wounded when a terrorist blew himself up in a large market in the center of the old city, 150 meters away from the shrine of Imam Ali bin Abi Talib, peace be upon him. The director of the Najaf health sector, Dr. Munthar Al Athari, said that the number of people killed and wounded was high due to the intensity of the explosion, which happened during the hustle and bustle of the early morning business hours.
In a chain of events in which terrorists targeted the holy shrines in Al Najaf Governorate, a terrorist wearing an explosive belt blew himself up in the middle of a group of visitors to the shrine of Ali, peace be upon him. The explosion martyred 33 people and wounded 108 others.
I came to visit the shrine. I showed my ID card and put my mobile phone over there. Less than 5 minutes after I entered the shrine, the explosions happened. So we ran outside. The man blew himself up near the security man, and the shrapnel hit everybody.
All 9 members of the security unit jumped on the suicide bomber, who had an explosive belt around him. None of them survived because as soon as they surrounded him, he blew himself up.
We came to the scene of the incident. Eyewitnesses said that the suicide bomber was heading towards the area surrounding the shrine with the intention of blowing up the shrine of Imam Ali, peace be upon him. But God prevented him, and the police arrested him. While he was being arrested, he blew himself up.
An infant girl, no more than 1.5 years old, was being breastfed by her mother, who was her source of life. But in just one moment, terrorism took her mother's life and thus cut off the source. This is one of the tragedies left behind by the terrorist attack.
When the explosion happened, the mother covered the infant with her body. The mother did not survive the explosion, but we pulled the infant alive from her mother's lap. We don't know the identity of this infant. Look, her face is burned. So far, we don't know what province she's from.
Angry reactions were clear on the faces of people after the incident. They demanded from the authorities to change the security plans and make more efforts to control breaches of security that the province has been suffering from recently.
The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. Please visit linktv.org/mosaic for more information about these broadcasters or to view previous Mosaic programs, obtain program transcripts, or receive the weekly Mosaic Intelligence Report. Mosaic is made possible by a grant from the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. Additional support is provided by the Firedoll Foundation, the Otto Haas Charitable Trust, and by committed Link TV viewers like you. If you value this program, please send your tax-deductible contribution to Link TV, either through the website or the mailing address listed on your screen. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. programs which connect you to the world.